Hi, my name is Chris and this is Battle Nonsense. If my gameplay of the Ironsight beta makes you think, oh my god, this looks like yet another cheap Call of Duty clone, then I really don't blame you, because I thought the same after I've seen the trailer. However, as it turns out, I could not have been more wrong. Not only do I really enjoy the gameplay and the map design of this free-to-play game, I also found that it's very interesting from a technical standpoint, which is why I decided to do a netcode analysis for it. I also got the chance to talk to the project manager of Ironsight. We discussed my test results, a few of the issues I found, and I learned some interesting details, which I will share with you in this video. Now, while I always do my best to keep the netcode analysis as simple as possible, you will still need to have some basic knowledge about computer networking, tick rates, update rates, network models, super bullets, lag compensation, packet loss, and a few other things, like how I do my network delay tests. So to keep the netcode analysis videos as short as possible, I've put all this information into a separate netcode 101 video, which you should have watched at least once before you continue with this video here. The card overlay, as well as the link in the description down below, will both take you directly to that video. So first of all, which network model does Ironsight use? Even in the latest Call of Duty game, players have no control over if they end up in a client-hosted match or on a dedicated game server. The game not only makes this decision on its own, it does not even tell the player if he is on a dedicated server or a listen server. And when you create a custom match in Call of Duty, then this will always be hosted by a player who then has the host advantage. Ironsight, on the other hand, uses dedicated servers for both public and custom matches, which means that no player has the host advantage. Currently, it's not possible to set a password when you create a custom match, but the developers will add that feature later, as well as more configuration options, an invite system, and much more to properly support custom matches and community tournaments. They seem very determined to provide everything the competitive scene needs to form and flourish. In the open beta, the game currently uses data centers in North America and Europe, which are provided by Google's cloud platform. More locations will be added later. However, the developers currently have no plans to support other cloud services like Microsoft's Azure or Amazon's AWS, which is a bit unfortunate as that could make their online services more robust. What you will notice here is that compared to hosters like Multiplay or Gameservers.com, none of these cloud services have data centers in South Africa, Russia, or near Turkey, which is not only bad news for players who live there, but more about that a little bit later. Now, how about the rates at which the clients and servers send and receive data? This is where it gets very interesting. Very simply put, the consensus among developers who work on online multiplayer games is that you should use the UDP protocol when your application has a real-time requirement on packet delivery. This is why you usually don't see an online multiplayer game use TCP for game data, as that protocol was designed to ensure that data always arrives at its target location, even if that means increasing the delay by waiting for the target to confirm that it received that data packet and resending it if it didn't. Ironsight, however, uses TCP instead of UDP. And while it uses the push flag to prevent TCP from buffering data and thus increasing the delay even under perfect network conditions, I still find this decision concerning, as TCP will cause very noticeable lag spikes as soon as there is packet loss, since TCP is more concerned about ensuring that data arrives at its target location than how long it takes to get it there and if that data is outdated when it arrives there. This is of course an extremely simplified explanation, but if you want to learn more about that topic, then you can find an excellent article about TCP versus UDP in the description down below. So I did ask the developers why they decided to use TCP, and I was told that one of the reasons is that some people don't have access to UDP, as that protocol might get blocked by a firewall or a router where NAT isn't working correctly. Now, based on research done by Google, about 8 to 9% of the internet population can't use UDP as it gets blocked by a firewall. However, that's mostly hotels, airports, and corporate networks. So for cases where a firewall does indeed block the online functionality of a game, I think that using TCP as a backup is a good solution. But I and other developers in the industry that I've talked to say that UDP is the first and only choice for applications such as online games where data is time critical. So in short, TCP can be as fast as UDP when you use the push flag and as long as the client has a perfect connection to the server, which is sadly not the case for most players. The Ironsight developers told me that they are exploring UDP for the future, but right now the game uses TCP, so we will have to wait and see how that affects the online experience of its growing player base. What is also interesting about the data that is sent and received by the game is that the send rate of both the client and the server depend on what the players do. When the players just stand around, then the clients send 25 updates per second and the server sends 22 updates per second. When one player fires his gun, then the send rate of both the client and the server increase. It looks like the client immediately sends the player input to the server, and the server then sends an update to the clients. The server's send rate can get as high as 240 Hz, as you can see here. Now, how much bandwidth do you need for these update rates? In my previous netcode analysis videos, I showed you how many megabytes a game downloaded and uploaded during 1 hour of playtime. That info was surely interesting, but it didn't really help gamers to find out if their internet connection can handle these games, as your ISP and every speed test website out there will tell you how many kilobits or megabits per second you can upload or download. So starting with this video, I will now show you the average and maximum kilobits and megabits per second that a game downloads and uploads while you are playing. Spikes that occur while the game is loading the map are not included. So when you look at these numbers, then Ironsight uses very little bandwidth and pretty much everyone should be able to play it. The 2.1 megabit per second spike for the download in Battlefield 1 occurs only when you press the deploy button, while the 1.7 megabit per second spike that you see for the download in Overwatch is caused by the game client downloading the deathcam data from the server after you got killed. I hope that you find this new information helpful, and please let me know in the comments down below what you think about this new chart. Now, the visual delay between players is not only affected by the update rates, but also the frame rate and the player's ping. Unlike most other games, even big-budget AAA titles, Ironsight has a very flexible frame rate limiter built right into the options menu, where players can set a specific FPS cap, which is especially useful for owners of a G-Sync or FreeSync monitor. Inside the options menu, you can also enable a display FPS option, which not only shows you the frame rate, but also your ping to the game server. That said, the ping display is not very reliable at the moment, as sometimes it will show you a ping of 0 milliseconds. But I have reported this issue to the developers, so I guess that we can expect a fix in the near future. Speaking of the ping value, Ironsight sadly does not show you the numerical ping value inside the scoreboard. Instead, we get those rather useless signal strength icons. However, this might change in the future, as I was told by the project manager. The developers also plan to include network icons later, which will then alert the player of packet loss or other issues with his connection to the server. Now, how about the network delay in Ironsight? Before I show you the results of my network delay tests, I want to ask you once again to watch the Netcode 101 video first to find out how I do these network delay tests, as that is required to understand what these results mean for your online experience. At an ICMP ping of 17 milliseconds to the game server, I measured an average damage delay of just 26.75 milliseconds and an average gunfire delay of only 29 milliseconds. These are by far the lowest delays that I have ever measured in a multiplayer game. The movement delay, however, is very long with 104.5 milliseconds on average, which is one of the reasons why you will frequently take damage behind cover, but more on that in a minute. The reason why the damage and gunfire delays are so incredibly short is that the game client does indeed send a gunshot immediately to the server, which according to the developers then processes this data in real time and then updates the players. The server does not use a fixed tick rate. Movement data, however, is only sent 25 times per second, which is why the movement delay is a lot longer. Now, even when we consider that Ironsight was tested at a ping of 17 milliseconds, while most other games were tested at a ping of 25 milliseconds, Ironsight still shows the lowest damage and gunfire delays of all games that I ever tested, which is very impressive. That said, the developers should increase the rate at which they update player movement, as more than 100 milliseconds on average is far too long at a ping of just 17 milliseconds. Now, besides the high movement delay, there is also the issue that the server compensates a lot of lag. Even at a ping of 400 milliseconds, shots will still register, which the other player then receives very far behind cover, as you can see here. What we must also keep in mind here is that Ironsight only uses Google's cloud platform, which does not yet provide servers in South Africa, Russia, or near Turkey. This means that players who live there will be forced to play on servers to which they have a very high ping. Not only will they have a bad experience then, but also players with a low ping will suffer, as they then receive damage far behind cover. So to ensure that all players have a good time, the developers must reduce that movement delay, add servers in locations where Google does not provide any, do something about how much lag the game compensates, and think about switching to UDP. Now, on a more personal note, I've got to say that I made the mistake of judging this book by its cover. It surely looks a lot like Call of Duty, but while I honestly got sick of that franchise over the last few years, I really enjoy the gameplay in Ironsight, especially the maps, as their design always allows you to flank and surprise the enemy. Also, based on my conversation that I had with the project manager, it sounds like they are not only committed to provide a good free-to-play experience where the microtransactions are limited to cosmetics, they also do listen to the feedback that they get from the community, and they are committed to build a game that is fun, competitive, and fair. So I want to encourage you to give Ironsight a shot, because it might surprise you too. You can find a link to its website in the description down below. So that's all for today. I will keep you updated on the progress that the developers make, and if you enjoyed this netcode analysis of Ironsight, then it would be great if you could support me on Patreon, as YouTube's ad revenue is sadly not enough anymore to run a niche channel like mine. Without the awesome support that I get from my patrons, Battle Nonsense would not exist anymore. You can find a link to my Patreon in the description down below, where you can also find links to my social accounts in case that you want to stay up to date on the videos that I'm working on. So if you enjoyed this video, then please give it a like, subscribe for more, and I hope to see you next time. Until then, have a nice day and take care. My name is Chris, and this was Battle Nonsense.